Process Explorer, a powerful free replacement for Task Manager. Hi everyone, Leo Notenboom here for askleo.com. Now, you may not need or even want to know what's going on under the hood in Windows. Most computers, you shouldn't have to. Computers are supposed to just work, and you should never need to be bothered with things like processes or resource utilization or whatnot. And yet, there are times when we want or even need to know. This is where Process Explorer comes in. Process Explorer, or frequently just ProcExp, provides a window into the world of all the programs running on your computer at a level of detailed information the Task Manager just doesn't reach. Now, to be clear, Task Manager in Windows 10 and Windows 11 is a good tool. It's certainly gotten better than its earlier incarnations. In fact, we'll fire it up here in Windows 11, and you can see that, yeah, there's a fair amount of interesting information about the applications and so forth running on your machine. It's one of those tools that, if you do nothing else, it's at least worth being familiar with. Like I said, Task Manager is good. But sometimes we want more. So Process Explorer is part of the SysInternals suite of programs. If you go to Microsoft Store, you can see that it is something you can get and install for free from the Microsoft Store. Just look for SysInternals, and eventually you'll see SysInternals suite. You can see I already have it installed here. What that means is that it's on the Start menu. In all, if we scroll all the way down to SysInternals suite, you'll see that there's a list of programs that were installed. These are all useful tools at various times, very geeky. Like I said, it's the internals of your system, as the name implies. The one we care about the most, and the one I'm talking about today, is Process Explorer. Not Process Monitor, that's something different, but Process Explorer. So, when you first fire it up, you'll get exactly what you might expect, which is a list of all of the processes running on your machine. This list includes all of the tasks or processes running. What's called the hierarchical view shows which processes started other processes, which could be a very interesting way to understand just how they all relate to each other. If I scroll down this list a little bit here, I'll take one example somewhere. So here we can see explorer.exe started the security health SysTray, which is one of the things in the notification area. It also started Microsoft Edge. Microsoft Edge started several different sub-processes of Microsoft Edge. Back at Explorer, at the same level of indentation, you can see that Explorer also started OneDrive. And it started Process Explorer, which is what we did when we ran it from the Start menu. There's a lot going on in this system. This is a small system. It's not doing much. I haven't even run any programs of note yet. And even so, down here at the bottom, you can see that it's running 185 processes. That is normal for current versions of Windows. It's just the way things are organized, the way that the software has been written. Could they do it in fewer processes? Sure, but it would be significantly less efficient and effective. It's one way that software is written to make the maximum use of the hardware that it's running on. All right, so here's the processes in this hierarchical view. We can change that to be alphabetical simply by clicking on this column header, Processes. Now we have everything in alphabetical view. If we scroll up and down, you can see that it's all in alphabetical order. And of course, if you want that in reverse alphabetical, you can click it again. And if you want to go back to hierarchical, click it one more time, and there you are. CPU usage is the column that we probably pay attention to the most. Whenever I'm firing up Process Explorer, it's because I'm interested in what the CPU is doing. If we click on that column header and scroll all the way back to the top, we are now showing the processes in order of CPU usage, which means that right now, the system idle process is typically at the top, and the processes that are kind of sort of all floating around using the next most amount of CPU usage are things like Process Explorer itself, because it's doing something. MSMP Engine, which is the anti-malware tool. It's basically Windows Security's background process. Or something like Tray Process, which is something from ESIS to do. You can see that this is updating once every second. Just shows you which programs are using the most CPU right now. The same can be done with the working set column. If I click on that, now we're looking at the processes in the order of physical memory actually used. As you might expect, this is perhaps the next most common. Who's eating up all my memory? Now, for the record, working set shows you how much physical memory is actually in use right now. Private bytes, the column to its left, if I go back to the top of this, that's showing you who's showing all the memory that is in use, but that doesn't include only RAM. It actually also includes memory that may have been swapped out to the system paging file. So private bytes shows the entire amount of memory attempting to be used by a program, both real and virtual, whereas working set shows you what's in RAM right now. I'm going to go ahead and go back to the hierarchical approach. For the record, you've seen this, and sometimes it could be annoying if you're, you know, flopping around here. You can see that there's a lot of information that is being displayed simply by hovering over any of the entries in the Process Explorer list. That is useful at times. For example, this particular case of MS Edge WebView2.exe, you can see it's showing you the command line that is being used, but it's also showing you where the program is and where the program came from. Bind handle or DLL is a really, really interesting tool. What we'll do is find filter processes is almost always useless. If I'm looking for a specific process, I will sort alphabetically and then just run down the list. It's find handle or DLL that's actually the most interesting. This allows you to search for something. That something can be a program name. It can be a file name. It can be a couple of other different kinds of things. Handles are a very generic term in Windows that can refer to a lot of different things that are accessed by programs. For example, I'm going to search for LNOTE. That is the user ID, the login ID of my currently logged in user. And right away, it's showing me a lot of different things. Now, I currently have this sorted by type. So what this is telling me is that these are all processes that are using DLLs that happen to be somewhere in user's LNOTE app data. In other words, a lot of programs store a lot of stuff in app data, and here's a bunch of them that are being referenced. If I scroll down, however, it's not just DLLs, which are other pieces of programs that are running, but instead, a lot of DLLs, you can see that it's also referencing various files. Now, in this particular case, you can see that this file, user's LNOTE app data, again, is a file that is being used by Edge as part of its cache. If I scroll down even further, there's random things called mutants, sections, tokens. These are all things that are being used by the various software, usually for inter-process communication, so one program can talk to another. But there's a lot of different things that are going on here. The important thing, and perhaps the single most useful aspect of this tool, is if you are looking for a specific file that is in use. In other words, something's got a file open and you can't access it for some reason. This will allow you to see which process has the file open simply by searching for the file name or even a part of the file name. Process details lets you dive into even more information about the various processes that are running here. I'm going to scroll all the way down here to where I've got we'll just look at trayprocess.exe since we know that that's coming from ESIS to do. I'm right-clicking on it. I'm clicking on Properties. Here's a dialogue that has a bunch of information about this specific executable. Where it is, what command line it was given when it was run, what its current folder is, where it's being run from automatically, who's running it. In other words, like I said, I'm the currently logged in user, so you can see that LNote is the user that caused this program to be run. But there's more. There's performance. You can see what kind of memory and CPU usage is going on, what kind of I/O is happening. You can see its performance graph. In other words, how much CPU has it been using over time? Is its memory usage increasing or decreasing? What's it doing for I/O? GPU. Some programs use GPU, the graphics processing unit. Others don't. How many threads there are? What those threads are doing. Threading is a way of using multiple CPU cores at the same time. It's basically a way to do multiple things at the same time. TCP/IP means, are there any network connections associated with this specific executable? There are not. Security tells you about which security context the program is running in, what it has access to. Environment. You may remember that there are environment settings that include things like the path, the current user, and so forth. That could be changed within the program as it's running. This is what it's currently seeing. And strings is an interesting one because all it's really doing is it's looking through the memory image of the program as it's running and identifying anything that kind of sort of looks like a string. There's a lot of different things in here that kind of sort of look like strings. Sometimes they're useful, sometimes they're not. But as you can see, there is a lot of information available about each specific process if you're interested in diving down. If you're not interested in drilling down, maybe you want to take a look from a higher perspective. System information, making sure that Process Explorer is running, we can hit Control-I. That shows us information about what the system is doing right now and gives us some interesting graphs over time. The top, of course, is CPU. We've talked about system commit, physical memory, how much of it's being used, how much I/O is happening right now. If I take my mouse and hover over the CPU graph, you can see which process was using the most CPU at that time. This is a great way to come back in and retroactively, you know, your machine is suddenly very slow. Something's using a lot of CPU, but by the time you're able to get to Process Explorer, you can't tell anymore because it's gone away. This lets you take a look at the history and identify who was doing what. CPU is a more detailed version of the CPU. It's basically a larger version. However, this also lets you do one graph per CPU. So if you've got multiple cores in your CPU, then you can see what each core is up to individually. Whether or not that's useful, that depends on what it is you're looking at. Memory usage, we've talked about that. This is giving us a lot of more information about exactly how much memory is used, what kind of memory is being used, and so forth. I/O, simple stuff. How much is being read and written to and from the disk, and if I'm not mistaken, also network connectivity. And of course, the GPU, which in our case isn't being used. As complicated as what I've just shown you seems to be, I've still only scratched the surface of some of the things that you can do and some of the things you can see in Process Explorer. It is one of my go-to tools whenever I'm diagnosing system issues. Honestly, I almost have it running constantly. I don't quite have it on auto start yet, but it's very quick that I end up running it for one reason or another, and then I just leave it running. Even if you don't have a problem to investigate, Process Explorer is worth installing and, well, exploring. There's a wealth of information available, and you'll get a good baseline of exactly what your system looks like when it's not experiencing a problem, which means that it'll be a little bit easier to detect what's going on or what's different when you are experiencing a problem. For updates, for comments, for links related to this topic and more, visit askleo.com/3480. I'm Leo Notenboom, and this is askleo.com. Thanks for watching.